Hey everyone, this is Blackbinder, and welcome back to the Let's Play of Pillars of Eternity 2, Deadfire. Last time we left off, we finally made it to the Rhymebound Temple, and Blith, her sister, we found her, but we couldn't convince her to leave, and she killed herself and put herself into a rhyme construct. But now, we are going further into the temple, so let's do this. Look at that. We got this soulbound bulwark shield thingy. Looks freaking sweet. Covered in rime. Rime is like, I think, the frosty bits on metal, like when metal frosts over. Oh, son of a gun. Yep, that's the white void back there that looks like the frost-hewn breach. Oh, it's pulling him back, I guess. Maybe because he failed Rymygrand? Well, good. We don't have to fight him again.
You see that? It was like something had a hold of its tail.
Or maybe we'll have to fight him in Rymygrand's realm. But the way they made it sound in the first game, if you cross over, you'll just be obliterated, even your soul. What you initially take for yet another frozen corpse appears on closer inspection to be a heavily armored figure encrusted in a jagged layer of cloudy bluish ice. The warrior's upraised hands seem to be reaching out towards something, the fingers splayed wide and grasping. Examine the outstretched hand. With me, because I have the best perception. Two of the fingers have been broken from the hand. Based on the hard, sharp edges of what's left, it seems this occurred after the figure froze over. Ow. Examine the outstretched hands. Let's try insight. Plus 12. Two of the fingers... Well... I don't get it. Okay, here we go. Here's the complete success part. The angle of the joints indicate that the warrior once gripped something tightly, something since removed. Deep scratches in the wrists suggest that someone clawed at the figure long after it froze over, perhaps to remove an absent object. Was it that thing we bought for 20,000? Examine the armor. With Aloth. Just a second. The breastplate and chain worn by this figure seem significantly more intricate than anything else you've seen since arriving at Harbinger's Watch. Padding and heavy cloth complete the panoply. The panoply? I've never heard that word before. Probably as protection against the cold. Hold on, I'm gonna sneeze. First sneeze of the episode. Alright, partial success. Layered chain and plate, highly adaptable, blah, 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 blah. Often proves popular with those travelers who can afford it. Members of military or religious orders in particular favor wearing armor like this kind. With their uniforms or vestments. The set before you appears to be of a style not commonly crafted in the past two centuries. Let's try examining it with her. Partial success. Barely visible through the ice, you can make out etching suggestive of the imagery of Rymygrand, snowflakes, skulls, and of course the horned face of the aurochs. Search for the presence of spirits. You open your soul to the presence of other spirits. While a few strands of weak soul energy cling to the frozen figure, you sense no soul present within or near the body. Remove the helmet. The helmet does not appear to be as solidly frozen to the figure as the rest of the armor. A few minutes spent wiggling and tugging at it frees the helm. You lift it to reveal an elven woman with bluish-white skin and darker blue hair. Her coloration and the heavy epicanthic folds... Epicanthic. Is that like, pugs, their nose? I don't know. Hooding her eyes mark her as a Glamfellan. Or as Glamfellan, so pale elf. White elf. You have gained an item, Helm of the White Void. What does it do? 10% of incoming grazes converted to misses, so that would be... good for Adair, because most things should be grazing him. Although grazes aren't particularly dangerous, though. Plus 10 accuracy with body affliction and mind affliction attacks. The shards of ice crowning this helm radiate a malignant chill, utterly resisting the glare of the Deadfire sun. It smells musty within, as if worn for centuries by the frozen corpse of a pale elf. You don't say! Too cold for comfort on even the hottest days, the helm plagues the wearer with endless whispers at the edge of hearing. Strangely, this helm looks far more like something you'd expect of Ynguithan than of the White That Wends. Yeah, it does kind of look Ynguithan. Leave it be. We can't get a partial, or we can't get a complete success on the insight and history. Alright, let's go to the Vitemont. I assume we'll survive the transition.
You stand before a shining portal that devoured the dragon. This close, you see it as a ragged-edged tear in the world. As you near, the portal flares bright. Brighter, too bright to stand. When the light fades, and at last you can see again, a great, shaggy aurochs stands before you. A bone-snapping chill radiates from the creature. It is the manifestation of Rymygrand.
Herald of Bereth, you teeter on the very precipice of your death to once again violate my realm. Do you desire dissolution after all?
I'm tired, Rymygrand. I'm ready for this all to be over. No, I have work yet to do.
Yes. Bereth does keep their hound on a short leash. Should you ever want for a final freedom from the pallid knight's grasp, seek me. I will gladly grant it. Passing through the breach will shred your soul into its constituent parts, to little more than wayward motes of essence. Knowing that, what do you want?
What happened to the dragon?
Her soul was drawn through the breach, the Vitemouth, and into the beyond. Neriskirlas has bound her soul to a relic from the days when the gods walked Eora as titans.
Neriskirlas?
This relic lies in the beyond, and it holds her soul captive there.
Who is Neriskirlas?
That is the name the dragon chose for herself.
What relic?
It is one of the many things Kith have thrown into the beyond, in hopes it might be devoured by the White Void.
Why did the dragon bind her soul to it?
The relic cannot be destroyed. In her ignorance, Neriskirlas hoped that tying her soul to it would save her from death. She is mistaken. True death has not claimed her yet, but it will. It is inevitable.
What's the difference between the Vitemouth and the White Void?
The Vitemouth is the gaping maw of entropy. The White Void is the hunger that gnaws at the guts of Eora and cannot be sated.
Is that why this iceberg is here?
Yes. The iceberg is the natural result of Neriskirlas's desperate attempt to
claim
death. Every time she escapes from the beyond into the here, she tears the hole a little. I would ask the same of you.
Gosh dang it.
Yes, every time she escapes from the beyond into the here, she tears the hole a little wider. And so, the chill of my realm spreads.
And your cult, the Harbingers, what about them?
They have done as Kith always do. They have claimed for themselves a place that is not their own. They are no concern of mine.
Your breach will freeze the Deadfire if you don't close it.
That is unfortunate for you.
Let's make a deal.
That you trust still in me, or any god to deal honestly with you, it is remarkable. Naive. But remarkable.
That's faith? No. Let's just say nothing.
There is something you may do for
You want
me.
Us to kill Neriskirlas? $20, that's what he wants us to do.
Like a maggot, the dragon Neriskirlas has burrowed beneath the skin of my realm. Destroy her.
Why do you want the dragon dead?
She is already dead. She refuses to acknowledge it. She has made herself immune to destruction by my hand, and in so doing, she mocks the very essence of my realm.
Why do you think I will succeed where you have failed?
The relic she bound her soul to has proven impervious to my influence.
So, I want to say this. I don't want to laugh, but I do want to say, so a Kith can do what the great god Rymygrand cannot?
I can yet do many things, Herald of Bereth.
A rime of frost grows at your feet. It coalesces, hardens, and begins to climb your legs. You're rooted in place, your limbs slowly growing numb. Say nothing, stoically.
The ice encasing your legs splinters and falls away. Unable to feel your feet, you tumble to the side, but are ably caught by your companion. A satisfied sigh escapes Rymygrands' decaying bovine mouth.
With pleasure, I guess. What's in it for me? No, I'm not your errand boy. Fine, with pleasure. It's the only one I can say. It's not really what I want to say.
A low rumble shakes the ground beneath your feet.
I would rather watch you fail than bar your entry. But you lack the means to enter the feet mouth and survive the journey. You must seek the eye of Rymygrand, a relic that once belonged to my vassal, Rhenider. It is a cold, blue stone, and it lies somewhere within this temple.
You mean this relic?
Indeed. Approach the feet mouth with the relic in hand. It will grant your soul safe passage into the shattered realms. The white void's only purpose is to destroy souls, and it is adept at doing so. I will not stop my servants there from their work. They will treat you no differently than any wayward soul. Should you fall to their predations, not even Bereth will be able to save you.
Rymygrand pauses, his dark cluster of eyes watching you intently.
One final thing, Watcher. You must destroy that dragon.
When his words fall silent, and only the shriek of the wind through the breach remains, the light flares again, then quickly dies. You open your eyes and find the beast gone.
All right, let's do this. We actually get to go there. That's awesome. Never thought it'd be possible.
The blinding light of the breach pulses in time with the heartbeat of Aeora. Your soul pulses in response.
Enter the breach. I can't imagine there's going to be anything there, though, but, like, what? Snow, maybe? Or something that looks like souls? There won't be any buildings or any ruins or anything. Unless, I guess, the servants of Rymygrand are allowed to build settlements? I don't know. I would kind of defeat the purpose of a white void. Following certain death. No, there are little ruins here. Whoa, that's a big guy. Well, good. You're going down, Scourge. What are our injuries? Minus 2 dexterity. That's the only thing that matters, and it's not that much. Switch to our bow because they have only medium deflection, and their piercing damage resistance is higher than their slashing. Let's have you Flame Pillar. Then I'm gonna have Seraphim Mind Blade since there's only two. I like watching it bounce. Oh, they did a Rymygrand's Call. Scourge and a Soul Collector. Oh, that's not an Auroch. I thought they were both Aurochs. Or Minotaur, whatever you want to call it. How much damage have you taken so far, Adair? 53. Alright, we're on our way. Oh, secret over here. What is that? And why would that be allowed here? Corrosive Soul Essence. Shaken for 26 seconds, 5.3 raw damage. So basically about 30, 40 raw damage over time. Why would this be here? That does not look like Rymygrand's realm. Who is that? That's the lady that we saw on the other side. Or it looks like, anyway.
You followed me into the abyss? Have you so little respect for the scant years your fragile form affords you?
The dragon growls through sword-like teeth, yet the meaning behind the sounds rings within your mind.
I know not why the short-sightedness of Kith continues to surprise me. Leave while the option remains, lest you be bound here as I am.
You're not trapped here, you just attacked Harbinger's watch.
A simple understanding of a complex situation.
Then help me understand.
No, I bear responsibility for neither your enlightenment nor your sophistication.
The great reptile's head cranes to the right, turning a glowing eye upon you. A snort flares her nostrils.
Descend into the void or do not. I care neither way, but know that within its depths do all things encounter their endings.
Well, at least she's a little bit more talkative this time. In the silence that follows the dragon's descent, a faint twinge plays along the hair of your arms. After a moment, you realize that the sensation stems from your soul, a faint echo of essence across your watcher senses. The fractured pieces of the armored spirit you saw rush to battle Nerisirlas reach out to you, beckoning. Where? Oh, Wandering Soul. Okay, so maybe it was that girl. Faintly pulsing strands of soul essence collect here as if seeking one another's comfort. As you reach out to it with your spirit, the broken soul seems to peer back at you. The damned dragon hisses as you drive the mace upward into the bottom of its jaw. It attempts to bat you away from the Vitemont, but you duck beneath its claws. You jam the edge of your shield into the side of its neck. You will not again allow it passage into the world of the living. With an abrupt shock of pain, the vision ends. The strands of the sundered soul cling to you like cobwebs. Okay, so let's put them back together. Getting a Final Fantasy VII vibe here. The faintly pulsing strands of soul essence stretch towards you, interweaving with those you collected before. The spirit grows stronger within you, the light stream where you put Cloud back together. It's an honor, your mother told you. The Altar of Decline rarely sends for Gondur among the clans, elite class of temple guards. But your heart breaks as the land recedes behind the ship. You never noticed it before, such warmth for your frigid home. But it is stark as day in its absence. You'll sail north, the captain tells you, keeping well to the west of Nausithak and its stout defenders. The journey... Nausithak, isn't that where, the dwarf ranger from the first game is from? The journey will take weeks, but it'll be quicker, he says as he points you toward the oars, if you're rowing with the rest of us. The roiling essence settles within you. Wait, where? I could have swore there was... Oh, there it is. The faintly pulsing strands of soul essence stretch towards you, interweaving with those you collected before. The spirit grows stronger within you. I imagine she puts herself together over time on her own, but we're speeding things up. Rinhadr, Olrun's daughter, dragged again before the elders for wandering. Never leave the clan without another, they'd said before, would say again, each time drumming into her shoulders with a staff of etched bone. The land is one of endings. The Beast of Winter's dread Demesne? I don't know what that word is. Dread Demesne, where he lurks beneath the snow, above the stars, and within red fangs and claws. Never walk alone. The girl will not learn. Bjarnlifull tells them, for her ears are frozen shut. She wants to hit him, but he's a bare-blooded adult grown, and she but a gawkish child of fish and berries. He's not worth another drumming. The elder silences him. She will learn, the wizened elf answers, or she will die. Regardless, she belongs to Rymygrand and not you. The reconstituted soul pulses like a heart. I want to go over here. Nothing there. Oh, that's, I'm guessing, where we need to go. Let's open this chest somehow, that there is a chest in the void. You've only approached the essence before it sweeps towards you, drawn into the growing soul clinging to your own. Frigid cold washes over you. You have to ignore the screaming to shut it out and focus. The dragon's at the doors, and you've but moments before it's breached them, before it's reached the Vitemont to sup on Rymygrand's gateway as it has so many of your kin. You will not allow it. In your prayers, you open the way to Rymygrand, forging a road for your soul. No, forging a road of your soul. From the here through the beyond and into the very depths of the white void, he accepts. The white mouth opens. Winter claims all. The spirit tears itself from you, stepping away even as it manifests a visible form. There we go. A soul stands before you, shimmering and indistinct, her sharp elven features fading to nothing at the edges and extremities. You recognize her form as that of the armored corpse standing frozen in the temple beyond the portal.
You trespass.
The soul's voice seems to come from everywhere at once, from her, from the air around you, and from within your own mind. Its chill runs down the sides of your neck, a numbness descending from your ears to your shoulders.
We ain't never been great with boundaries, friend.
I have an invitation.
Yes, you and all others. Yet you arrived before the appointment.
Hey, we have the same shield. Her brow furrows.
Or perhaps after.
The figure takes a step closer and the air grows colder, drier. Frost spreads from her feet.
You retain yourself, your life, your awareness, your soul. How?
Show her the Eye of Rymygrand. Rymygrand gave me this. No, he didn't. We took it from the imp, or we bought it. The spirit's eyes widen as she reaches towards the orb. She stops short, fingers twitching, before letting her hand drop to her side. Her attention falls to the frozen ground.
Your presence suggests that Rymygrand has chosen a new guardian to put the worm to the blade. To succeed where I have failed.
You tried to kill that monster? Do you know what it is?
Before it came here, it was a dragon. What it has become since, exactly, I cannot say. It fell upon our temple, wielding powerful wizardry. I believed that it desired the temple itself, or our accumulated lore. I was mistaken.
What was the dragon after?
Rymygrand gifted our people with a veat mouth that we might yield to him. Those objects or individuals that persisted beyond their value to the clans. In its desire to dominate the Deadfire, the worm sought to retrieve one or more of the sacrificed relics.
Her scowl twists into a smirk.
Even if it claimed the relics, the fool cannot return. Its body long since destroyed.
Well, it has returned a couple times.
Still, its soul persists against the power of this place. And I would see it ended.
That can't have just been its soul. We hit it with a weapon. The dragon seemed pretty solid when I fought it outside the temple, yeah.
It was but a shadow forged of spirit stuff, by the worm's own will.
Ah, okay.
Similar in form and function to a chanter's summon. How unusual.
I need to find that dragon.
Then you must seek it below. Know that the white void will consume you, however. A few souls here cling tenaciously to coherence. Some for as long as centuries. Seek them, if you would know the secrets of their longevity. This place decomposes spirits. Do not be surprised if the souls require repair before rendering you aid. I imagine, though, that the Beast of Winter would prefer you hasten their dissolution.
I'll help if I can. Rynhader bows her head to you.
In its desperate thrashing, the worm has scattered this ruined realm. You may find your way stymied as you proceed. Do not fear to forge the path you seek.
I don't know what that means, but okay. The endless queries. What is this? A beam of clear, radiant light cuts through the murky expanse of the beyond. The air around it is notably warmer than the rest of this realm. Look into the light. The source of the illumination is too distant, and the effort of looking hurts your eyes. You suspect the light is something more than it seems, but that could be true of many things in this realm. Alright, well, we will figure that out as we go. We need to forge our own path, so I need to, make this colder so it freezes over? We need to figure out how to get rid of that light.
Greetings again, walker between worlds. Was there something else you wished to ask?
Can you tell me more about these echo realms?
I can tell you of but three. There are others, but they exist beyond my ken. Each reflects the souls within. Spirits adrift upon the calamity that claimed them. Some souls cling more tightly than others. A drowned kingdom of salt and coral. A copper realm chained in questions.
Ingwithin.
These were here when I arrived. The third realm is young yet. And as hot as a festival flame.
Was that Widewind? I bet that's where Widewind went. He was who Aethys possessed before. What did you mean by chained in questions?
I know no other words for it. Agonized screams echo through its halls, and great machines churn above masked querents.
It is an ancient nightmare, sustained by the bitterness and spite of the Kith within.
There's an entire sunken kingdom down here?
Yes. And also no.
She frowns, forehead wrinkling in her attempt to find the words that will form an adequate explanation.
More the echo of the kingdom's end. The whole of it fell in one.
Oh, that's the Hwana. The Hwana one.
The stubborn blindness of its chieftain has kept it suspended above the void for centuries or longer. It is the eldest of the realms accessible from here. And the most thoroughly decayed.
You know nothing else of the youngest realm?
Fresh and raw, that wound. In its agony, it revisits itself.
Are there other realms?
There were, in the past. I remember a palace of golden smoke. Gone now. A temple of shifting halls. Also gone.
The endless paths, maybe? She frowns, almost wincing.
These realms fell away, consumed by the white void.
Alright, I wanted to ask you something else about the dragon.
Ask your questions, then, if they will see the worm ended.
I killed the dragon and it revived. How do I kill it permanently?
I wish I had that answer. Perhaps it would be enough to fight it in this place. To weaken its grip that it might finally fall into the void. Perhaps it found the relic it sought. Its soul clinging to that object in place of an earthly form. If that object were found, perhaps it could be delivered to the Beast of Winter for dissolution. I can't risk falling on her perhaps, however. Not with a gate to hold.
Where did the dragon come from?
From the north.
She frowns down at her
the
hands.
Beast of the Deadfire, set on dominating that place as a snowbird dominates its hunting grounds. No creature, dragon or kith, rivaled it. Yet it was not content and turned its eyes against the gods.
What's it doing here?
Rymygrand gifted our people with a beet mouth that we might yield to its desire to dominate. Even if it claimed the relics, the fool cannot return. Its body long since destroyed.
Do you know where it came by such powers?
I do not. It ate a wizard, perhaps?
You mentioned before that the dragon used wizardry.
Yes. Even before it came to us, tales had reached us from the north. The worm's abilities were not limited to its fangs, claws, and breath. It commanded eldritch energies.
I want to talk about something else. She nods, her eyes never leaving yours. I'm curious about your homeland and people. Why is it called the White That Wends?
Rather than the deceased flame or the land of deer.
I doubt there are many deer to be found in the White That Wends.
We Glamfellans simply call it the land. Outsiders call it the White That Wends. Likely because much of it is white and can be difficult to navigate for the uninitiated.
What is the White That Wends like?
How does a person explain their home when they've only ever seen it with their own eyes? Travelers will claim it an endless expanse of white, featureless and bare. I would point to the jagged rises, the plunging coasts, the sheer rifts, to the blight storms and the snow bears, and ask of them, do you not see? Still, few kith call the land home. Only Glamfellan and the Inutinic. They possess the resolve, the vigor, required to endure the Beast of Winter's withering attentions.
What is the Inutinic? The Boreal Dwarves. Sounds incredible, thank you.
It pains me little to speak of home.
She bows her head. We're not at the White That Wends, so we can't say that option. Can you tell me more about the Pale Elves?
Most Glamfellan reside within the White That Wends, where we travel in clans. Life in the land can be harsh, but it provides. The clan raises the young communally, each member passing on their expertise. That every child has the skills demanded by the land. Each clan is as much family as nation.
Not their parents?
The mother helps raise the child, of course. But paternity can sometimes be difficult to determine. Each child is a child of the clan first and foremost.
You sound like you miss it.
I love the land and I love my people. But that life ended long ago, as all things do.
Does the Glamfellan have any particular feelings about the Wood Elves?
I have little experience with the shelter folk of Air Glamfath. They do not welcome us among the lands. We do some trading with the adherents.
What is the relationship between the Glamfellan and Rymygrand?
We have long venerated Rymygrand as the eldest, strongest, and wisest of the gods. He claimed the land as his kingdom, and we as his people. My eldest taught that we fell from the beast of winter's fur as it marched across the land. The first Glamfellan, equal parts salt, snow, and divine spirit.
What does veneration of Rymygrand entail?
Prayer, song, dance, sacrifice, the use of blessed relics, the defense of sacred sites.
With a smile, she gestures back towards the swirling pearlescent plain of the Vitemouth.
Our priests augur his will in the entrails of the slain. They guide our travels across the land, and we embrace the inevitable difficulties that ensue.
Did your elder tell you where Rymygrand came from?
Like all endings, he was inevitable from the beginning. The babe of spring demanded a beast of winter. My mother told me once that she believed them one in the same, that, like you, like me, Rymygrand was born to die. Unlike us, however. His birth gave birth to birthing, and his death will end death. He lit the flame, and he shall bury the ashes.
What of the other gods?
They each sing their song. The flame keeps us warm. The sea provides fish, the land flesh. Each provides temporary comfort against the cold, and we thank them for their gifts. But only Rymygrand awaits us in the white void.
All right, that's everything, I think. Yep. All right, let's, we don't want to go down there yet. So let's go onward to the Endless Queries. See what that's like and then end the episode. The portal whispers, sounding at first like the rain, but resolving into the quiet murmuring of lowered voices in a large room. Gaze into its depths. Beyond its surface, you see vast pillars of Audra wrapped in the stone arches and copper machinery of ancient Engwith. Step into the portal. Yeah, I was right. Engwith. Engwithans. Speak to the shackled soul. I have a feeling that's going to take a while, so we will save that for next time. I wonder if Taos is down here.
These structures are of Ingwithin make. They look to be new. Strange.
Alright, well that's where we will end it for now. So please leave a like or comment below and feel free to subscribe for more full Let's Plays like this one. And that's my mama.